However, we did say this is going to cross over to Europe. Europe is gloating that they've been able to pick up resources out of Latin America for
No,
nothing.
you said that in 2002 on my show. The
Yeah.
transcript of it is a chapter in my book that's out of print, sent to tyranny, but it's posted here at prisonplanet.tv. We only got about 10 minutes left with you. You've been very gracious of joining us here this evening, Greg. I'll get you back on the radio soon. And it's all in Vulture's Picnic, available at Amazon, bookstores everywhere. In fact, I was just at Barnes & Noble last week and picked up another copy for family. They had a big end cap of them there, so that must be selling quite well if it's at the end cap at Barnes & Noble. So people are hungry for the truth. But I want to go back, because I interrupted running off into a side issue. Let's go back to News Corp. What is News Corp at its heart? Because you were the first I've ever seen saying all this. I'm like, really, Greg? It's kind of a creepy group, influence peddling, spying on people, telling Downing Street what to do. Now it's all come out. Hiring police, spying on people, everything you said. And it's actually in your book. Funny it came out or was being written right as this broke, you know, how they were
The thing.
saying you were full of it earlier. But now it's come out. I mean, who are they really? And then you were getting off into CNN, the fact that this isn't
Yeah,
just,
both.
News Corp now.
You bet. It's the whole crew. But I, like I say, I went in wearing a wire, using a false front operation for the Observer, and then later BBC joined in, where we did secret recording of Murdoch's lobbyists, and they laid the whole thing out. They don't see themselves as a media company. They see themselves as a political information organization. In other words, to make their money, media, like, you can't just make money by opening a radio or TV station or a web outlet. You know how difficult that is if you really have to compete on the merits. This is all about buying and selling spectrum, buying and selling control of airwaves. And so for Murdoch, everything, for News Corp, everything is about their political connection, their ability to lock things up and lock others out. And so the lobbyists were explaining that basically they are the conduit for a business elite, and secondarily the political elite, so that they're not so much for or against a particular candidate. And you notice that Murdoch will switch back and forth on who he backs.
Sure, he's
He's
influence
backed up.
peddling.
So, it's basically up for the highest bidder. What does he want? Very concerned about getting the China and Southeast Asia market right now. And they need the political help of the European governments and the US government. So that's Murdoch and News Corp. Then you have, at the same you have Time Warner, CNN. And what Piers Morgan was one of the people, when I remember when I went undercover, the first thing that they had to do was discredit me. So Piers Morgan, who was in this operation, he was editor of the Daily Mail, one of the tabloid papers there. And Morgan basically set up a deal where well, to put it this way, I was trying to get more information going undercover. I was wearing a wire, and I thought, well, one way to get some information is there was a very fairly good-looking woman, quite good-looking woman, who was very close to Tony Blair, a rising young political star, and I thought that I could get some information from her probably easier if we had less clothes on. That wouldn't have been so bad, except that her husband walked in, and I could have dealt with that. But the main thing was that Piers Morgan had set this up so that his photographer came in, and they used that to try to discredit me by, so I was all over the front
And again,
pages of the
you're working
British
hard for
paper.
the story. I mean, we.
Yeah. So, okay. But by the way, I got the story, and that's what they didn't like. And the story, by the way, involved Enron. It involved the big power company, Southern Company of the US. It involved these huge power companies that were basically buying up influence. And News Corp. In News Corp, Entergy, which is very, very close to the Clintons. Okay. So there's Bill Clinton, Hillary Clinton, and Entergy Corporation. There was Enron, which is the Bushes. There was News Corp. I was getting this information and how Blair was basically, Tony Blair was selling out his government. And of course, I'm getting the information about the US government because it involves the Clintons and Entergy. This Little Rock company, by the way, a tiny company from Little Rock, was given ownership of London Electricity, if you can imagine this gigantic operation. Then they flip it to the French, to Electricité de France after holding it a couple months and make $2 billion, right? So $2 billion is made out of thin air, really close friends of the Clintons, right? This is how it all works. So I'm getting this information, and yeah, okay, so my zipper was down, so they caught me with my pants off. Yeah, okay, but you know what? They can discredit me, but they couldn't discredit the evidence. And it is to the great, great thanks to The Guardian and BBC that they didn't care, that they didn't care whether my pants are up or down. The important thing is that the information I had was rock solid.
Yeah, what matters is that
was a story.
What matters is that it was true what you were saying, and it's certainly all been borne out. Now, I tell you, this is incredible information, Greg. I'm going to air part of this on the radio tomorrow. In fact, the last 15 minutes has, I think, been some of the best TV/radio we've ever done. Just amazing information. That's the kind of stuff that people will find in this book, Vultures Picnic, and they certainly are vultures. Shifting gears now to the last question. We see Hillary saying it's a new peace war. We need to invade Syria with peacekeepers, peace bombs for Libya. I'm no fan of Gaddafi. I'm no fan of Assad. I'm no fan of Mubarak. But they're replacing them with Muslim Brotherhood. They're torturing the ambassador to France. They're killing thousands of black people. They're lining folks up and shooting them. The real humanitarian disaster has now happened. AFRICOM is admitting they're invading Africa through there. I want to get your perspective, but this is what I've seen. And now we're being lectured, and I'm seeing the CIA operative, Anderson Cooper, with this young guy up there one night going, they are killing us 40,000 today. Next day, he's got a perfect English accent. Their actor is so bad, you know, on these shows, he can't even get that straight. So the whole thing is obviously a baby thrown out of the incubator story. And again, not a fan of Assad, but they admit Al-Qaeda is the main group in Libya. They're shipping Al-Qaeda into Syria. I thought I had to let the TSA stick their hands down my pants and my wife's pants because Al-Qaeda was going to get me and was hiding under every table. But now Al-Qaeda, I'm being told, are some good people. So I'm confused. What's going on here?
Would you believe it? It's about the oil. And what's happening, Syria doesn't have oil per se, but this is about control by Saudi Arabia over a Shia land, the Syria and Assad. Assad is an Alawite, which is a sect which is split off from the Shia, which are absolutely hated and despised by the Saudis.
So he's a minority of a minority of the most hated right. group by the Wahhabist.
Right. And so what they want to do, they see an opportunity. Now, of course, well, I agree with you. Assad is an absolute fanatic murderer. But you notice that when he killed 10,000 of his own people in the city of Hama, we just, you know, whistled. We didn't care about that. It's just that now the Saudis have said, now that the Saudis are out to get him, suddenly we're concerned. And that disturbs me. Again, Assad is a murderer. When his dad killed those 10,000 innocent people and we said nothing, it made me sick. And to see the son now repeat the same trick, it also makes me sick. But what makes me sicker in some way is to say, well, we're finally going to say something about it, maybe do something about it, because the Saudis don't want him there. And part of it is religious, but also part of it is a showdown with Iran over control of OPEC. And the control of the Shia Crescent. Remember that Saudi Arabia moved into Bahrain. I realize it's a little complex, but Bahrain was facing an uprising by a Shia majority against a Sunni monarchy backed by the Saudis. The Saudis cannot afford to have Shia-controlled nations or they're going to lose control of the oil routes.
Exactly. Our media acts like all the Arabs want to kill Christians and Jews when it's an incredibly diverse group and they're busy with their own empires hating and killing each other much more than they supposedly hate the West. From my meager research, you've done more and been over there a lot more. Is that a fair statement?
Yeah, I mean, their battles are internal within the Islamic religion, huge internal battles, which also obviously go to resources. And you see this split in places that you haven't heard of, but wait till the 101st Airborne gets there. I was just in Vultures Picnic. I was in Baku, Azerbaijan, which is one of those new Islamic republics. I call it the Islamic Republic of BP. We're going to end up there. Once again, you've got the problem where you have a Sunni dictators, who was the old KGB chief, right? He went from being a good communist to being a good Muslim, right? And the reason why he's a good Muslim in our view, and now he's our great ally, is that he's given a contract to BP Amoco, which is now one company, by the
way. Okay, so let me ask you this question then in closing. Where is it all going? Should we just step back and let them all kill each other? What would then happen in the West? Obviously, we pay for the empire, really don't get many of the goods, just being honest about it. And how does somebody like Ron Paul, in your view, tie in with the demonization, the clear election fraud, the system coming after him? I haven't asked Greg Palast his view on Ron Paul.
Well, the main thing is what's going to happen now in these Islamic republics. In the case of Assad, it's horrible to have him stay there and murder his people. What I do worry about is bringing in the dark night of Wahhabism as the alternative. I just spoke to one of my a friend of mine who is an Arabic speaker. He's Arabic. And he earned his PhD on the Muslim Brotherhood. And he said Egypt is going to devolve into another kind of Iran light. Yes, we do have problems. We were paying, as you said, with Al-Qaeda, we were paying the Taliban to allow shipments across Afghanistan. The realpolitik of the Mideast is getting more and more complex, slick with oil. And now we're adding, by the way, uranium in Islamic nations like Niger. So it's a multi-level chessboard. Now, I can't say I understand all the pieces. I obviously, as an investigative reporter, I've been going to these places and getting inside as much as I can to try to understand it. But obviously, it's not as simple as Assad, the bad guy, who was a good guy last week. Look, we went through this. Saddam was our ally when he was murdering people left and right.
Well, here's what I'm saying. Obviously, the West isn't going in there to put a democracy in. And obviously, you're going to end up having the Wahhabists in a big war with the Shiites now in Syria, and it'll be 10 times the deaths. I mean, look what Libya's turned into.
I'm very concerned that what we are doing is igniting, for the purposes of Saudi control of the area, that we're igniting an intra-Islamic war. And maybe some people think that's good. Go let them kill each other. You know what? That ain't going to be good for us. That's not going to be good for this planet. If there is a continuing massive war that's within Islam, fomented by war over oil and uranium, and now rare earths like cobalt and other rare earth minerals, which are now becoming another major source of contention in places like Afghanistan. All very, right. Very concerned about this.
All right. Well, incredible interview. Greg Palast, thank you so much for the time. GregPalast.com, the book Vultures Picnic. And I know we were late getting you on, so I'm going to sign off with you now. Thank you so much for the time, Greg.
You're the best, Alex. Really. Thanks.
Thank you, sir. All right. Amazing, in-depth, candid, teleprompter-free, no script, real information. That's Greg Palast. Please thank him for joining us.